Welcome to our sessions on White House communications from the perspective of officials and reporters. Tonight we have as our guest Carl Cannon, who is fresh from the White House Correspondents Association dinner, where Carl is president, has just finished up a year as president of the White House Correspondents Association, and he was the one who had to organize the dinner. And if you think about the hassle that's involved in organizing a dinner for about 10 or 15 people, you can imagine what it must be like to organize a dinner for 2,700. And 2,700 people who, some of whom have fairly large egos and a sense of where they'd like to sit and with whom they would like to sit. So Carl is, in addition to his role as president of the Correspondents Association, which we will we'll talk about how far back that goes. Carl is a White House correspondent for National Journal. You know, as you know, there are two White House correspondents. We had Alexis Simmendinger came in, and we had a session with Alexis in the classroom. And Carl, before he was at National Journal, worked for the Baltimore Sun. And before the Baltimore Sun, he worked for several newspapers, including the San Jose Mercury News. So you have both a California experience and a Maryland experience. Carl is known for his very good writing and for the scope of his stories, that he always corrals a lot of information and a lot of people in a large variety of stories. He writes not just about the White House, but there are a lot of other issues that he's interested in, that he's written about, such as death penalty and issues that have nothing to do with politics. For example, Carl has written about wolves. And so he does a lot of freelance pieces in addition to his White House work. So we have a variety of things to ask him about and the experiences that he brings to his work. Carl, can you tell us something, since you've got fresh in your mind the Correspondents Association? What is it that the White House Correspondents Association does?
Well, its original purpose, I won't say its original purpose, but its primary purpose is to interact with the White House and ensure we get access to the president. And you know from your time over there, the inclination of every president is to keep us at bay. And the last three or four administrations has had a plan to take our White House press room away from us right there in the main, and move us across to the old executive office buildings, now the old Eisenhower building. This plan's so old, the buildings changed names, but they still haven't gotten us over there yet. And so the president of the White House Correspondents Association is supposed to deal with the White House and all these issues, where we can go in the building, access to the president on trips, when we take trips, the charters. It's the truth of it is it's a much more involved job. Nobody who knew what you have to do would actually take the job. But by the time you find out, you're in your term. It's a one-year term, and then you leave. But that's its primary job. We also have a scholarship program, and we're very proud of, and we do that.
You've done a lot of work in building up that scholarship program.
Well, when I first came in, we were getting some bad publicity. There's always these snotty stories written. The Washington Post had a couple of them the last 2 days about our dinner, which is our sort of third great function to do this dinner. And I thought, you know, we're doing all this stuff, and this scholarship program we have, it's okay, but we don't put enough time and energy into it. And so I revamped it a little bit, and my idea was to make it more for students, based it a little more on need, and have it be oriented towards kids who want to someday cover the White House, maybe. That's my idea. And so, yeah, I put some time into that. And then there's the dinner itself, which is one night a year, and we get together, and now it's a big thing because Hollywood people come, but before it was not that. It's a time, and if you're a White House correspondent, for every Hollywood person that goes, there's 50 or 100 or 200 source types, you know, Washington professionals, everybody from Karl Rove down to a press secretary in a congressman's office that some local reporter is taking. And you go to the dinner and you dress up in a tuxedo, and that one night a year you're not doing battle. You're trying to get to meet the person on the other side. And form, you know, make a source and have a good time. Salute the president.
Somebody was asking me the other night, when you talk to the president, what is the protocol? and what kinds of things do you talk about and not talk about? I know it's off the record, so.
You know, it's not really off the record.
Uh-huh.
It's I hesitate to even say this but you got a nice looking class there. I'll go ahead and. It's ambiguous.
It's also video streaming.
That's fine, but the truth of it is, for many years, there's an ambivalence to it,
uh-huh.
of whether it's off the record or not. That for that one, you couldn't have that be any kind of permanent situation. But for that one night, it serves its purposes because if the president really wants to keep something a secret, he knows not to tell three reporters on a stand in front of 2,000 other reporters.
Right.
So he's not up there spilling secrets. But on the other hand, if he, if he belches into his napkin, or says some aside to his wife about how crummy the entree was, we don't use that. I don't think we're supposed to.
Uh-huh.
But like I say, presidents don't spill state secrets by accident. So there's not that kind of thing. The idea is that you're up there with him. He doesn't have to come to the dinner. He doesn't have to sit with him. So you're not going to use something that would gratuitously embarrass him. That at least is my understanding.
Uh-huh. And the kinds of things that you talk about. Like you talk about sports and
well, President Bush in the 2 years I've had dinner with
Carl
him.
Carl is a really good baseball.
Well, I like
player.
Baseball, and so does
yeah.
Bush. We talk about baseball, but
yeah.
really he's less interested in that than he was. We
uh-huh.
talked 2 nights ago about bringing baseball to Washington,
mm-hmm.
and the president really wasn't conversant with it. And I know when he came to office, it's something he wanted to do,
mm-hmm.
and I think this war has forced him to. Reorder his priorities, and baseball
right.
is no longer where it was with him, which was an interesting
uh-huh.
thing I noticed. I was
uh-huh.
disappointed in a way because I like baseball in Washington.
Yeah.
But he's not engaged in that anymore. But he also talked about, some of his conversations 2 years ago at the dinner. He talked about Yasser Arafat and how disappointed he was that Arafat didn't seem to be able to go from
mm-hmm.
revolutionary to mm-hmm. statesman, to make that leap for peace.
Uh-huh.
He talked about that in front of us.
Uh-huh.
Without hesitation.
Uh-huh.
So it runs the whole gamut.
Uh-huh. Oh, that is interesting. In the kind of work that you all do in dealing with access issues, how much time does that kind of thing take up? How often are there issues? Are there just a constant stream of issues that need to be dealt with?
There are issues daily. They range from what charter should we get and the press plane. When we follow the president around, we pay our expenses, as you know. We pay the plane, we pay the hotel, the phones, everything. It's very expensive to travel mm-hmm. with the president. And these news organizations that do spend many more times as amount as they would on the salary of an extra reporter. So it's a commitment.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have to pick the plane, and the networks and I vote, and it's kind of involved. Every day you do something like that.
Uh-huh.
And then there are site surveys where a president goes on foreign trips. They send out, the White House sends a team of advanced people. We're allowed to tag along so we can write a report for our people on what to see in the country. The Correspondents Association president has to find someone to take those trips. And
mm-hmm.
there's just, it's kind of boring, but it's time consuming.
Uh-huh. Well, you took a recent trip in preparation for the president's trip to Normandy.
Right.
What kinds of things do you do on a trip like that?
Well, that is off the record, but I'll tell you what I can tell you.
Yeah.
I mean, it's no secret the president's going to Normandy. That's
yeah.
the 60th anniversary. And we go and we look at the sites. And sometimes in previous administrations, I think they ask the TV people, what would make a good shot,
mm-hmm.
a picture. This White House is careful not to do that,
mm-hmm.
either because they don't care what we think or I don't know. But
they have their own people.
They have their own people.
With a network background. They have
yeah.
Scott Sforza. They
That's
just
right.
take Scott Sforza along.
That's right. They do that. So they didn't ask us any questions, but they let us tag along. And when they want to talk about something privately, they huddle and they put us on a separate bus. It's very much being a second-class citizen. But I didn't go to hang around with them. I went to go to Normandy.
Uh-huh.
And I got to walk on the battlefields alone and the beaches of Normandy. It was very moving, actually.
Uh-huh.
That was a trip I took myself. You see, it comes in, who are you going to sign? And I waited uh-huh. till it was too late to assign anyone else and just took the trip. The only perk.
I think people just don't have an idea of how expensive it really is to travel with the president. Can you give us some ideas in a couple of trips that the president has taken, like his trip to Asia? Do you remember how much those
the
those
fee
ran?
For the charter itself, and that includes meals And some of the filing center costs, but not all, was about $22,000. 8-day trip.
Uh-huh. That so was you, one to
yeah, Asia. To Asia. And he went to all these countries, Singapore and Australia. Mm-hmm. Of course, the summit at Tokyo. Mm-hmm. The event itself, he stopped in Bali. The event mm-hmm. itself was in Thailand. So he did all these countries in 7 days. Yeah. It'd be expensive if you wanted to fly anyway, but still. You can see, extrapolate on one right. week of travel,
yeah.
how expensive it is for these papers like the LA Times and the New York Times and the Washington Post that make every trip.
Mm-hmm.
It's several $100,000 a year.
How many news organizations do make all of the trips?
Well, those three newspapers, and they're the only ones now, those
uh-huh.
three papers that make every trip. The Wall Street Journal and the USA Today make most of the trips.
Uh-huh.
The Wires, Reuters and AP and Bloomberg make all the trips,
mm-hmm.
usually with two people.
Uh-huh.
And then the networks, of course. The networks make very nearly every trip, all five networks.
And how many people do they have?
Depends, but if
they have
a full crew, you know, you're talking about, they have to take two crews on a trip that's newsworthy, they sometimes can take, you know, 15 people.
Yeah.
10. It adds up.
It certainly is.
Yeah.
That definitely adds up. One of the important things that we've talked about reporting is the way in which the role the press has in its relationship with the public and with the White House. And Helen and Thomas and several others, reporters as well, have talked about the role of the press as a surrogate, that they see themselves as reporters, as a surrogate for the public. What role do you see for yourself?
Well, National Journal doesn't have a huge, you know, mass circulation. But it sounds corny, but that's what, you know, I still think of journalism as a calling, and our job is to try and interpret what the president's doing without any partisan tinge, and that's harder for some reporters than others.
Mm-hmm.
What the president's doing and how he fits into the historic context, what's his job in office?
Mm-hmm.
And you'd hope that if your readers saw what you saw, they'd come to the same conclusions you come to.
Mm-hmm.
So I try not to be too directive. I don't write stories telling people what to think. I try to describe what the president's doing, how it's being received, if I'm able to judge how effective it is. I try and write analytical pieces, I don't want to tell people what to think.
Mm-hmm.
I want to try and show them what he's doing.
Do you have in your mind a reader that you write towards? Like Don Folsom used to talk about the milkman from Buffalo.
Yeah.
For his wife's radio reporting.
All right, now this is really going to sound corny. When I covered Clinton for 5 years for the Baltimore Sun, and my mom lived in that town and read the paper. She read every story I wrote. And so I would sit down at the typewriter and I would sort of think, you know, oh, okay, yeah. Don't want to piss mom off, you know.
Uh-huh.
I want mom to think I'm being fair. She kind of liked Clinton. So, you know, I would think of her.
Uh-huh.
My mother had high school education, a couple years at junior college, and avid reader, very bright, not formally educated, very interested in civic affairs, but not an activist. And
mm-hmm.
she was who I had in mind.
Uh-huh.
Now, National Journal is different. It's a smaller circulation. This is going to embarrass you, but when I write for the National Journal, sometimes I have you in mind. I think, if Martha thinks this story is okay, this is going to be okay. And sometimes I have to make extra calls because I'm thinking of that. Some of them to you. Class, I got to tell you one thing. I used to tease Martha that I made her famous, but that wasn't really true. But what I did do, I quoted her at the Baltimore Sun a couple of times. And finally, and when you work for the Baltimore Sun, which is a regional paper that used to be a national newspaper and still wants to cover national affairs, and you find the world's expert on something on your beat, White House Communications, who happens to teach at Towson State, that's about as good as it gets. And so finally my bureau chief said, how did you find this woman? Are you making her up? I said, no, she really exists.
Yeah, we go back a number of years here. And when you were reporting for The Sun, one of the things that that I remember, I pulled up all of your stories, and And I found that that you called political scientists all over the country. And, for example, you used Nelson Polsby, I remember. And at a regional paper, that's often not the case, that people would have a stable of experts on the presidency, not just in particular policy issues. Is that something you brought with you to the Sun, or you developed while you were there?
Well, you know, I'm from California. I grew up there, and mm-hmm. Californians think of themselves as belonging to virtually a nation state. When I first came to Washington, I worked for a paper, the San Jose Mercury News, and they were very liberal about what constituted regional news. They said, you know, I didn't have to get San Jose in the lead. I had to get the words California in the story. Well, one out of eight Americans is a Californian. The president was from California. It wasn't too hard to do. And so early on in my Washington reporting, I decided that, you know, you can be as broad as you want. You can be as sort of sweeping as you want. There's no harm to it. And it was that attitude I brought to the White House beat. You mentioned earlier that I wrote about wolves, mm-hmm. but I really wrote about them off the White House beat. And that's what's so wonderful about that beat is you can write about any issue that you possibly care about, mm-hmm. anything that comes to mind. The reason the northern gray wolf was released into the wild in Yellowstone National Park in the mid-1990s was because a Democrat had won the election, Bill Clinton, and he appointed Bruce Babbitt as his Interior Secretary. So that was very much a political story in its origins. Mm-hmm. The Park Service had wanted to do this for years, but the Reagan administration and then the first Bush administration wouldn't do it because the Western Republican senators were very much opposed to it. But I could see this was going to happen. I had long-standing interest in the subject. So I went out there and did a story, but off the White House beat. And that was so that's what makes
that. That's interesting. Yeah. Yes, I had not remembered it was off the beat. One of the challenges of White House beat is that you have so many different subjects to write on, but it's difficult to bring policy expertise into the White House. I mean, most people come from political reporting, and so it's kind of challenging to deal with foreign policy issues and to deal with economic issues because everything seems to get sucked into a White House, every kind of issue.
Well, that's the danger, is that if you're writing about everything, you know, you're really writing about nothing. You're not advancing the thought. I was no kind of expert on the Middle East, and still I'm not. But, you know, I've reluctantly realized if you're going to cover the White House, you have to learn about that subject. Mm-hmm. And because the president is very much involved in every administration, going back to Truman, I mean, it's an issue that you have to know about.
Right.
But you can't know every issue. But some of these reporters have to write about every issue, and I think that's one of the dangers of daily journalism, is these instant judgments, these superficial stories that reporters feel compelled to make. I gravitated towards to National Journal in part so I wouldn't have to do that kind of journalism. Mm-hmm. It's not as satisfying. At National Journal, I can take the time and inform myself before I write.
Mm-hmm. How do you choose what stories you're going to write on?
Well, that's the perennial problem in Washington. I remember when I first came here, I called a friend of mine back in California. She said, "What's it like there?" I said, "You can't believe it. The stories are lying in the street. All you have to do is scoop down and bend down and pick them up." And it's still like that. And it's like that, especially on the White House beat. Every week, Alexis and I have, you know, six stories we can write, and we have to pick one. Mm-hmm. And you pick one that you hope is either intrinsically interesting to you, and that's where subjectivity comes in, or that's important and you think you're going to be ahead of the curve, or you have a chance to break news, advance the story. All these things go into it, and ultimately you decide what's doable, mm-hmm. and then you try and do it.
Mm-hmm. What role does the editor have? Does your editor have?
Well,
do they come up with story ideas as well?
Depends who the editor is. When Michael Kelly was our editor, you knew Michael, he was killed in Iraq. He would always come up with ideas. And I learned that if you didn't have an idea at that magazine, he was going to have one for you. The editors we have now are more dependent on Alexis and I to generate our ideas, which mm-hmm. we're able to do because we've been on the beat a while.
Mm-hmm. When you're choosing your subjects, thinking of things that would be good to write about, you were talking about how at Baltimore Sun, your mom was your target. What about at National Journal? who are you thinking of as your reader in National Journal?
Well, our readership is, you know, members of Congress, lobbyists, White House people, presidential scholars. They're people who are pretty well informed. Mm-hmm. And so we assume when we write a story that the person reading our story is also reading the Post and the New York Times.
That's right.
So it's an informed readership, and you have to give them a little value added, as they like to say in business.
Uh-huh.
So that's who we think. It's a well-informed person
uh-huh.
of either ideological bent or no ideological bent, but a well-informed person.
What kind of responses do you get from your stories from the White House?
You know, this is true of every White House, but they don't tend to call you unless they have a bone to pick.
Uh-huh.
And heck, that's true generally of people you write about. You know, you get it right, they don't call and say, man, you spelled my name right, you got the facts right, you understand the nuance, and that history you brought in was great. I was really delighted you didn't screw me. They don't say that. They call when you have some little thing wrong or something. Nothing you can do about it.
When it's a White House, do you have the White House call? Have you had White House call about stories of yours?
I got a call last week from the White House because a quote I gave to USA Today quoted me in terms of in context of my job as White House Correspondents Association president. They were doing a story about the Woodward book, and they called me, and the guy misquoted me. It was weird. He quoted me and then had another quote that someone else must have said and then used my name, and they called. They were irritated, you know, because it wasn't, you know, something like they never call me back. And the guy called and said, we always call you back. I said, well, I didn't say it. And the guy said, it's funny, it didn't sound like you. So my point is, they're reading this stuff.
Uh-huh.
And I think the best thing that can happen is if they never call you. Apparently that means you got it right. It's frustrating. You don't know if they're reading it, but I think that's the best, if you never hear from them.
When you're putting together your stories, and you're kind of like, say you're planning things out for a month or something like that, thinking through some of the things that you would like to do, is there a certain kind of mixture, that there are things that are just all enterprise, that don't deal with covering what the president has been doing? Do you have a mix where you have, or is everything enterprise?
That kind of long-term planning, almost none of it's enterprise anymore. That
uh-huh.
kind of long-term planning, to me, in my experience, went away with 9/11. Jeffrey Birnbaum, you remember him?
Yeah.
Covered the White House for the Wall Street Journal. He wrote a book, and through the eyes of four or five people working in the Clinton administration.
Right, I remember that, yeah.
And afterwards, I asked him about it, and he said that the book hadn't quite turned out the way he thought because he hadn't understood how reactive the job is of being a White House aide.
Mm-hmm.
Is that you're reacting to things.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, they're not even able to set their own agenda. And so the people who cover them, we're not able to set our own agenda either, even less than they are. And I think that's been true even much more since 9/11. I mean, Bush came in. What did he want to do? Cut taxes, get the Republicans in the ball game on education policy, restore civility to Washington, bring baseball to Washington. Well, civility was never, that's impossible. But in the other two, he did. And he was going to be sort of a, you know, average president, historians would never, he had an agenda for himself that he's, if he was successful, he'd have been a nobody. But now he's a wartime president. And that's all, best I can tell, that's mostly what he does and thinks about. And so we always have to react.
Mm-hmm.
He reacts to world events and we react to him. And even at National Journal, where we'll take a step back and try not just write the news of the day or the news of the hour and try and get a handle on it, but you're still writing about things that he's doing, and he's still reacting to the events in a very uncertain world.
Mm-hmm. How has coverage changed? And how has the relationship with the White House and the kinds of reporting changed with 9/11?
Well, you remember, I don't know how many of these students, but if they haven't seen it, saw that movie that Nancy Pelosi's daughter did. You remember?
I haven't seen it yet.
You know the name of it?
George. Travels with George?
Something like that.
Yeah.
You see Bush in the campaign, this easygoing, fun-loving guy, gentle, kind of this gentle humor, needling the reporters, really getting along with him. He didn't know what kind of president he was going to be, and we didn't either. But I think the coverage of Bush in that campaign, he was very accessible. That's a funny thing. People don't remember this. Much more accessible than Gore. Now we think of this president as being not very accessible. And even when he's accessible on a personal level, like at the dinner, his administration has these layers between mm-hmm. us and him, and they're always on message and very controlling, hard to penetrate White House. But that's not how Bush was before. And I think part of that's the war. I just think the whole tenor of everything is different over there. Mm-hmm. These stories they tell of Bush, you know, within hours, within minutes, saying, this changes everything, we're at war, this is what we do now. I believe that. I think that's serious. I think that's that mm-hmm. that whole shift, and it affected very much the press relations, because, you know, they've gone to great lengths to have Woodward be sort of the chronicler, mm-hmm. one guy. Mm-hmm. And he's a guy they trust, and they trust him to sell bestsellers. They haven't done that with any other reporters. They've controlled access to him very closely. I don't think they would have done that if it hadn't been a war.
Do you think, he was going to, Woodward was going to be writing a book on taxes. He started out writing the book on taxes.
Right.
And they had made the decision to cooperate with him, because I know one person I talked to said that that you didn't have any choice, because he had so much material, so much access to people that
well, it's always smart to operate with Bob. Bob wouldn't have been silent for 4 years, but I'm uh-huh. saying that idea that they're going to tell our story to one person. In fact, Bush had a joke about it the other night in the dinner. He said, he was talking about these press conferences, and he's saying, well, you know, I've got a new idea. Instead of having a press conference, I'll just call Woodward and I'll tell him and he can tell you. But I don't think it would have been that way if we'd have had a peaceful 4 years.
What do you think the benefits are of the president and others talking to, and then he have others talk to Bob Woodward?
Well, answer your question in two ways. First of all, it's smart to talk to Woodward, because he's going to do the book anyway, mm-hmm. and at least you get your story out. But if your question is it smart only to talk to Woodward, I don't think it is. Mm-hmm. I think it's against their interest. I think there ought to be other reporters. I've nominated myself and others to get in there to talk to him. I think he had more press conferences. I don't understand what they're afraid of. The guy does well in those press conferences. Maybe not in our eyes, but his poll numbers tick up. Mm-hmm. People like him. Mm-hmm. The few swing voters we still have left, they like him. The Republicans like him. He seems to do well in this. And you remember in the Clinton administration, Clinton held far fewer press conferences than he should have. He did very well in them. I don't know what they're afraid of. Yeah. Maybe you know more than me about that.
Well, I was going to ask you about that.
Yeah.
I mean, we've been talking about press conferences, and you can see in the years that go from 1913 to 1953 that the press conferences were frequent, but those were off the record. And so there was a degree of vulnerability, especially because off the record really meant off the record. People did not take anything out, so they didn't have to risk things appearing where if they made a mistake. And presidents right. always seem to worry about making mistakes, even though they rarely do. And then 1953 forward, they become less frequent. The scheduling becomes somewhat erratic. And
yes, but Eisenhower and Kennedy had a lot more than any president that we've had in the last 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
did.
Yeah. So
Eisenhower had them more frequently than Kennedy did. And right.
It's not straight line, but it's almost been a steadily declining.
Declined down. Because in 1953 they went on the record in December of 1953, and then they became televised in 1955.
But that's what before this dinner, I went and got this archival footage I saw of Eisenhower I'd never seen before. I mean, he was so clearly in command of himself.
He was. The segment that you used was an interesting one, where he was talking about Sarah McClendon asked him about Nixon. This was in August, August 24th, I think, in 1960. Asked him about what decisions Nixon had been involved in, and it was very interesting, because he just clearly said that he's president.
The first thing he said was, I don't understand why anybody doesn't understand this. The only one who can make a decision is me. He says uh-huh. it like that. Then Charlie Moore asks him the follow-up, and he says, well, if you give me a week, I'll think of one, which is the famous line. Yeah. But if you look back on it, it's not the most memorable. It's not even the most memorable line on that subject from that press conference. That line to Sarah McClendon, that's the real line.
It was, yeah. Yeah, because you got, and it demonstrated one of the important things about press conferences. You get a sense of the president themselves.
Right.
And you certainly got that from him.
Well, it wouldn't have surprised, you know, it's funny, we wouldn't have surprised Americans at the time who knew about Eisenhower, who knew what a hard ass he was. I mean, in a good way, this general who'd led, the five-star general, who'd gotten Montgomery, to do what he wanted, we'd been humiliated in North Africa, and 2 years later he launches the greatest armada the world had ever seen and will ever see. And he fired people, West Point classmates. He fired one guy, cashiered him, ended his career, a general who casually made a bet with another general on the date of the D-Day landing. And Ike thought that could help it leak out. Fired the guy. Sent him back to the United States in humiliation. Americans knew about Eisenhower, knew he was a very forceful person. Mm-hmm. We have this sort of revisionist view of the Eisenhower years as nothing happened, but a lot happened, and this guy was the top guy, mm-hmm. and everybody around him knew it.
Mm-hmm. What when you go to a press conference, do you come in with a group of questions?
Well, you're supposed to.
I
got one for you. At the Rose Garden press conference last summer, I'm there. I had nothing to ask. I just was going to watch that day. I know there's always so many people want to ask questions. Believe me, there's no danger to that. But there is with this president, because I could see that he had a list. I could see he was looking down before he called on people. And he called on somebody right in front of me, and I thought, she didn't even have her hand up. And I thought, that son of a gun is liable to call on me. So I thought, what do I want to know about? So I scribbled out a question real fast, and he called on me the very next question. I sounded like I was smart, on top of it, White House reporter. Man, I could have, who knows? But I asked him about AIDS in Africa and actually got a real answer out of him, and he mentioned it to me a year later. I mean, so it was very fortunate, though. I could have been like, and I think it was Alan Embry. There was some reporter in the Reagan years who decided to skip a press conference. Reagan did the same thing. He'd call on. This guy is home in his living room, and Reagan calls on him by name, and the story, and it's maybe apocryphal, is he stands up in his living room and says, yes, Mr. President. Could have been me.
So he was still on the seating chart,
though.
Well, there was a speech that Ron Suskind gave, because he and Michael Barone at the University of Southern California recently. And Suskind talked about how the White House correspondents give their questions in to the into the president, and then the president selects from 6 or 7 questions. And I just wondered how anybody could get such a wrong-headed view of how a press conference worked. And so I thought one thing we can do here is talk about how questions actually come. I think that really what must have happened in his case is, remember in the press conference on March 6 in 2003, the president was talking about his script. What he meant to say,
he said these things are scripted, mm-hmm. and he was kidding in a way, but what he meant was he was talking about himself. He was saying that he had a script of who to call on. Mm-hmm. But there are some people, mostly on the left, who took that and they put on the internet and this went around. And
you know,
the Paul Krugman types thought, and Suskind, the people out to get Bush said, oh, well, see, it's scripted. They're submitting their questions, and they know better. Nobody really thinks that. Mm-hmm. Who's serious about it? But, you know, there's a funny thing. This happened with Reagan, too, and that is some of these writers from the left are out to get Bush. They're out to get Bush, and then the first thing they notice is that, you know, well, what about this favorable, you know, what about these poll numbers? You know, we think he's an idiot and a menace, but he has these high poll numbers. Ah, it must be the press's fault. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there's a word for that in philosophy. I forget what it is, but the gist, you go, you know, 1 + 1 = 47. Uh-huh. But, you know, it never dawns on maybe some people just like the guy because they like him. And so but this contributes. And so then the reporters then think, well, I got to be tough on him. I'm getting beaten up. And so then we're tough on him. And then the people who like Bush says, oh, the press is out to get him. And this goes on, and people talking past each other. And it's like speaking in tongues, you know, and nobody can even understand what's being done. So if we can shed a little light on it here, fine. Yes, we go to the press conference. We have questions that we think are tough, not ideological, not unfair, but tough. The idea is to put the guy on the spot for his policies so that he'll defend him. Or not, or make a mistake, or it's somehow you want the guy to think on his feet. And so sometimes a question will be provocatively phrased. It's not to try and ridicule the president, but it's to try and get him off of his talking point, because he's rehearsed, and you want to try and get him around that. So just, you want to see the president thinking on his feet. Why? Because you want to take your measure of the guy. He's the leader. So that's what we do.
Can you think of some questions where presidents, you've seen presidents talking on subjects that they had not planned on, like, say, Bush on AIDS, and then I've got another one for you that you asked of Clinton, and in both cases, you got some sense of them and their thinking.
Well, that AIDS question, it turns out Bush was well briefed on it. He thought about it, and he had an answer. He was ready for the question. He had no idea I was going to ask it. As I said, I didn't know I was going to ask it, but he was ready. He had an answer. His answer basically was, he asked for $15 billion for AIDS for Africa, I think over 5 years, but he wasn't allocating, he wasn't even asking Congress for enough money, it didn't look like, to get to the $15 billion. His answer was that the in-year numbers had to be lower because there was no infrastructure for just dealing with this kind of money. He didn't want it. Wasted or stolen. That's his answer. The AIDS groups weren't entirely satisfied with it, but it was clear he thought it through and knew what he was talking about. But yeah, sometimes presidents just go on. Sometimes some question will get them thinking, and they'll drive their aides crazy and delight us by just talking out of off the top of their head. Something strikes their fancy, some question. My favorite example, you can ask, you bring up that Clinton thing in a minute, but before I forget, this was Reagan. We went on a trip with Reagan. I wasn't covering the Reagan administration full time, but I was filling in to Boston. And he went, had a beer with Tip O'Neill in an Irish bar, and walked in Southie, and then went to Route 128. It was a high-tech corridor. Here was a guy who was governor of California when Silicon Valley, you know, became what it, the right. technology engine of the world. And to my knowledge, he never mentioned the word Silicon Valley. He's not a Reagan was never confused with a high-tech guru, you know. But they set up this trip for him to get nice pictures, and there was a business roundtable conference. And Reagan, we're on the second floor filing center. We're all writing these stories, and all the regulars are kind of, oh, this is, you know, he had a beer with Tip. It's just, they feel like he completely won the day because nothing happened outside the script. I was working for the San Jose Mercury News, and it was a great day for me because we were writing about technology and blah, blah, blah. But I was happy with my story. Everybody else was unhappy with theirs. And then at the end of the day, I mean, literally, you could hear the helicopter rotors going. They were about to get Reagan onto Marine One to beat him back to Washington. And Reagan says, you know, I'll probably get in trouble for saying this, but, and the electricity in the press room, it was like your hair stood up. People just, this was like the scent, you know, to a setter. And Reagan went on to say, I really don't know what justifies the corporate income tax. Why do we even have a corporate income tax? And he just went on ruminating like this. And that may be great Cato Institute, you know, politics, but economics. But I mean, and the reporters, all you see just ripping their stories out, calling their desk, okay, chief, I got a lead for you. It was like old-fashioned journalism. It was fabulous. And his aides put their hands in their face like this. And all this day, this scripted nonsense, having a beer with Tip, was out the window. You know, in the headlines, you know, Reagan says we should dump the corporate income tax. In fact, on the bus back to the airport, the aides were in tears, you know, who'd advanced the trip. And Bruce Drake, who's now with National Public Radio, NPR, he's the managing editor. He was the White House correspondent for the New York Daily News. And he said, and he was a great mimic, and he said, here's Reagan tomorrow at the NSC meeting. He says, you know, I've been thinking about this, and I don't understand why we have a Soviet Union. Isn't it time to do away with the Soviet Union? And everything Reagan had said, corporate income tax, he substituted the Soviet Union. And this deputy press secretary started crying audibly in the back of the bus. I said, Bruce, you're going to, really, you're hurting her feelings. He said, oh. It was very funny, actually.
I remember you asked Clinton a question about China, and it was not one that was it was not a big issue at the time. And I can't remember what aspect of our China policy it was, but it was one he clearly had not prepared for. But what was interesting was how he lit up at the idea of it, because he really enjoyed it. And so you could get a sense of the degree to which he really enjoyed talking about policy, even in particularly getting something that he hadn't been prepared for.
That's true. Clinton loved talking about policy. He didn't even mind if you stumped him. He seemed to grudgingly respect it. If it was on policy.
Not personal stuff.
He always called on me. You were there 8 years calling me. I wrote some very tough stories about him, but always called on me because I was always asking about policy, and he knew he'd get a policy question. And one time, I asked him, he ran in 1996 about doing away with the most hated tax in America, the capital gains tax on the selling of your home. Mm-hmm. And he put this in a long litany of things he'd do. And I was toying with the idea then of moving to Montana. I had this idea, I sell my house, I buy a house in Montana. Now, that went by the boards because Montana, you know, became so popular, has California land prices and Nebraska wages, and there's no way to do it. But I asked him this question, and he looked at me, you could look it up, and he said, I am going to do everything I said in that speech. Everything, and he did. Mm-hmm. And later someone, Mark Guerin or somebody said, that, I can't remember who, but said that Clinton told me, you tell Carl, it's okay, he can go to Montana. But he was that into the details, you know, of what was happening. And that was a good thing about covering him. It was an appealing part mm-hmm. of that administration to have the guy that interested.
Well, you know, one of the things that you can see, say, on policy, that in the Clinton administration, there was a lot of policy that came out of the White House. And you had briefings on the policy. You had briefings on a regular basis by the cabinet secretaries, by economic policy. Bruce, you had Gene Sperling came out, and Bruce Reed came out on domestic policy of various sorts, or Chris Jennings on health policy. OMB director would be briefing on a regular basis as well. Jack Lew was over there a lot towards the end. But in this administration, you don't have those same analogous people coming out. What do you think the consequences of, what are the origins of that, do you think, of the difference in presenting policy from a White House, and what are the consequences of it?
Martha, that's a complicated question. Let me take a stab at it, though.
It has parts.
All right.
There's no right answer.
Well, the first part of it is, the first thing I would say is this. Bush has a suspicion of the press that Clinton didn't have, in that he thinks we're liberals and he's a conservative and we'll screw him the same way he did his dad. That's in a short nutshell mm-hmm. Bush's view. There's nothing wrong with any of those theses. They're right. We are liberal. We did screw his dad. But to me, the old man was jogging. 41 was jogging. You could look this up, too. It was in the Washington Post, and it was maybe October, a month before the election. And the numbers came out, the economic numbers, and it was clear that the recession was over and had been over for a long time, and the economy was roaring. And Bush sort of smiled and said, Bush 41, well, I like to see the Washington Post, you know, say this isn't good news. Next day, you know, banner headline. You know, economy appears to be coming back, and then the subtext, but economists doubt. And the whole story is basically pissing on this good news. And the Bushies remember this kind of thing. And so in the Bush family memory, we're never going to give them a break. That's their view. Now, I would argue that the way this administration deals with information, because what you said is absolutely true, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. There's no way we could give them a break on some of this stuff because they're not briefing us, they're not helping mm-hmm. us, they're not helping us do our jobs in a way that I think would be in mm-hmm. their interest. That's the second part of what you asked, actually the third. Well, the effects of it to me are they don't get good coverage that they ought to mm-hmm. get. How about the economy? I mean, all the economists I've interviewed, all of them, none of them, I don't know if you can still call Paul Krugman an economist, he's now a polemicist instead, but all of them say that this job lag in the recovery is not Bush's fault, and in fact, it's no one's fault. It's just the way the economy works. But they've been And they'll say this. You know, you can get this out of them. But they have done a poor job of getting that story out, of briefing us, of explaining why this is so, of mm-hmm. taking reports, doing what you're saying. And so I can see it from both sides, but from where I sit, it's not in their interest. It's certainly not in my interest, but it's mm-hmm. not in theirs. But the other part of the question is that, the other part of the answer, I think, is that, as I said before, I think Bush is solely preoccupied with this war. And I think some of these issues that Bill Clinton talked about, Bush might have talked about them if the world had been different, but he's just not interested. He's not interested in baseball in Washington or school uniforms or, you know, or the capital gains tax on homeowners. I mean, he's interested in victory in Iraq. And what Bush has done, it seems to me, is embark this nation on a big, big idea, a big experiment, and it's going to fail or succeed. And the stakes are so high that we won't remember these other things. These other issues that he could have been talking about really are beside mm-hmm. the point. Because if the United States fails in Iraq, the ramifications are so negative to this country and so dangerous that Bush will be remembered as a failed president, but not on little things, not a failure to communicate on tax policy, a failure in mm-hmm. to perform in office, a failure as a commander-in-chief. If, on the other hand, a democracy takes root in that country and spreads to the rest of the Arab world, and what he's talked about is nothing less than that, mm-hmm. he will be remembered as a great president on a par with not just Reagan, but Roosevelt, Lincoln. Mm-hmm. And so the stakes are so high that if they don't have their eye on the ball in some of this on-the-ground domestic policy, it's understandable. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm not saying I think we need more briefings and press conferences, and I'm on the record with that all the time, and I'm always bugging them about it. But from their standpoint, I think that they just have this big issue they're preoccupied with.
Mm-hmm. And looking at how they've dealt with it, it is enormous. It's an enormous set of issues of national security and foreign policy and the way they intersect. There have been a whole raft of books recently about how the White House operates from one vantage point or another, from Karen Hughes's viewpoint, what she's seen of the president. Paul O'Neill has a very different take, and Bob Woodward is taking this issue and talking from multiple points of view there. What have you learned from all of them about how the decision-making process works in the Bush White House? Are there things that you've learned from them?
Well, let's separate Woodward's book out for a minute, his two books. That's a separate issue to me. It's a separate genre. Uh-huh. Let's talk about Joseph Wilson's book and the O'Neill-Susskind book and the Hughes book.
And Richard Clark
book. These books are they're what Michael Packingham, my old friend from the Baltimore Sun, the book review editor, are called non-books. They're not really books at all. They're self-serving screeds. I'm perfect, everyone around me is an idiot books. Karen Hughes, not me. George Bush is perfect, everyone else who criticizes him an idiot. It's sort of the mirror image. Those are not real books, and I haven't learned what I would have liked to have learned from them, because there's nothing in it. I don't trust what's in those books. Woodward book's different. The Woodward book shows Bush as more engaged than is commonly believed, and raises a whole bunch of questions, really. It turns out that Bush is skeptical of the intelligence on WMD himself. Mm-hmm. In the most riveting scene of the whole Bush presidency, to me, he asked these questions. The questions we wondered why he didn't ask. Turns out he did ask. And Tenet jumps up and says, it's a slam dunk. Uh-huh. And so you've got the vice president and the Defense Department, you know, urging action, and you got the CIA director saying that this guy is trying to acquire these weapons, and Bush is assured, without evidence, but with a slogan, that it's mm-hmm. true, and he defers to the expert. And it may show the limitations of the MBA management style of the presidency. He's treating it like he's really deferring. Mm-hmm. He suspends his own doubts.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And that's that one scene to me is worth all the trees it took that to cut down all these crappy books.
Uh-huh.
Because you got that one good book and you got that one good scene.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that that presidents learn while they're in office, and that they make changes? For example, there's going to undoubtedly a lot about the whole decision-making process, particularly with the quality of information coming into the White House. Are there ways that you've seen presidents in the past learn from mistakes that they might have made,
or
processes that didn't work very well?
Absolutely. I'll give you an example in this film that, sorry, class, I was supposed to bring it, but I didn't bring it. But I'll give it to Martha and some subsequent thing she can play it for you. But there's a press conference that Clinton is asked. Actually, this isn't in there. We cut this out, so that's okay. Do you remember this? He announces Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Oh, yeah. Brick,
yeah. Yeah, when would that have been? 93? 94? It was early.
Yeah.
I think it was 93.
It was Rose Garden.
And yeah, I think it was 93, maybe 94.
And
Brit Hume, who's in with ABC, stands up and says a question, and the gist of the question is, because they had leaked four or five names, they were wholly disorganized, and they finally stumbled across Ginsburg. They held this ceremony in the Rose Garden that was, it was maudlin. It was something like the old Soviet Union would have had. It was this, they introduced Ginsburg and spoke for an hour, and the word Sandra Day O'Connor never passed from their lips. It was like you would have thought she was the first woman on the court, Ruth. And I guess to them she was. She was the first woman Democrat. And so it was this strange thing, but she gave her biographical statement, and it was a nice statement, Ruth Bader Ginsburg did. And then Brit Hume stood up and asked this question. It turned out to be the shortest press conference ever, because it was the only question Clinton entertained. And he said, you know, you have a certain zigzag quality to the decision-making around here. Could you disabuse us of that notion? And Clinton, and you look at Clinton, and he looks so young, and he's so angry, he looks like he's going to burst into tears, and he berates Britt, and he says, after that statement you heard, how could you possibly even ask a question like that? I could never disabuse you of anything. And he storms off. And then the next clip I had in my sequence that I was looking at was, he's in the East Room, he's asked by Sam Donaldson if he's committed forcible rape against a woman in Arkansas who leveled this accusation against him. And he sort of deflects the view. Yeah, I talked to my lawyer. You know, I've answered that. You know, I'm doing the people's business. Uh-huh. He was calm and reassuring and very much more in his interest. And what Clinton learned how to do, at great personal pain to himself and the nation, was to answer very hostile personal questions. Before, he would answer questions that weren't even personal, as though you'd attacked his mother. And in his second term, he would answer the most hostile, vicious question with a very presidential manner. And so you could see the growth in him right before your eyes if you covered all 8 years, which I did. It was very impressive.
And it's also the growth of his staff and what they had learned. Because one thing that they learned was, I remember an aide saying that there's an answer in there, and you have to draw that answer out. And that it's not enough to say you're going to get this question about Monica Lewinsky or whatever. They would have a session beforehand, a long session, in which they would pose the question to him, and he would get very angry, and then they'd say, well, you could answer.
Okay,
that.
You got that out of your system.
That's right. So you might think about this one. And so occasionally, when he wasn't prepared, like in 96, when he came out in August of 96 and was asked a question that he hadn't anticipated, he really blew off at Bill Plant.
Right.
On one.
Well, and the other thing about the two terms, you know, it's a shame. I mean, 8 years, you finally learn the job, and then according to the Constitution, you have to leave. But but I remember in 1994, in the midterm elections, I was covering the White House for the Baltimore Sun. I was out in Arizona playing baseball. Took a week off, election week. My bureau chief was not happy about it, but he was immeasurably less happy about it when it turns out the Republicans had this historic sweep and captured both houses of the Congress, and Clinton held a press conference and declared that he was still relevant. I'm still president. And I came back to Washington a little bit, walked in the office on Monday morning a little sheepishly, and our congressional reporter walked up to me and said, you know, while you were gone, your beat disappeared. It was all very funny, and I didn't mind eating crow. But I also remember thinking, no, that's not true. My beat did not disappear. This man's still commander-in-chief of the United States Armed Forces. He's still president of the United States. No, it didn't. But I think Clinton had. I think Clinton went through that same process himself. I think the full power of that office, he learned after the Republicans took over, and he had this budget shutdown, in which he himself decided to shut down the budget rather than take cuts he didn't want, and then blame the Republicans for shutting down the government. And Clinton won coming and going. He didn't have to sign a budget he didn't like, and the Republicans got blamed. Mm-hmm. And what Clinton realized in those two sessions, they were a year apart actually, was the enormous power of this office as a communication, as a platform for communicating, and he took full advantage of it. And he became, in those years with this Republican Congress, you know, he, in boxing parlance, we'd say he was a counterpuncher. But, you know, a lot of counterpunchers became champions of the world, and so did Bill Clinton.
I know there, Dick Neustadt at one time had talked about how the election in 94 really focused his attention in a way that it had not been before. And it got him to organize, as he had not done either. And so you could see the growth, and certainly in their process. Have you seen? Well, I guess here we see a change in the Bush presidency of before and after September 11th. But are we going to see changes in the decision making process or relationships with institutions outside of the White House?
Well, this would be interesting. If President Bush is afforded a second term, and that's uncertain, but he must realize that he has to do a better job of bringing the Democrats in on domestic policy. He must see that. He's mentioned it a couple times actually in passing, and it's veiled. But you know, he had Ted Kennedy with him on the No Child Left Behind Act, very much with him, and he's lost him on that. And he seems to have lost Kennedy on everything. Bush still respects Kennedy. He doesn't quite understand what's happened to Kennedy. Now, partly what's happened is that wartime, this happens in war. People pick sides, and you're suddenly arguing about stuff that really matters. It's life and death. And Kennedy's on the other side. He spoke very forcefully against the Iraq invasion and didn't vote for it. So he's lost him partly on that. But he's also lost him in another way. This No Child Left Behind Act, Kennedy took some heat for Bush. Did Bush call up Kennedy and say, okay, how much money do you, you know, the Democrats have this funny position on it. They're saying it's the worst law ever passed, and it should never have been passed, and it's immoral and horrible, and it's not fully funded. that strikes Bush as peculiar and ought to. But as you'd think a second term Bush would know to call Kennedy and say, okay, fine, how much money do you need? So that you know, of course, federal spending has gone way up on education. To say that the thing is not funded is, put it charitably, untruth. But it's not funded to the degree these people want it funded. And it's some, you'd think a president who was focused on this and really cared about comedy, ITY, comedy in Washington, would call up the leading Democrat on this issue and say, what do you need? And these are the kind of calls that weren't made. So if you were looking, if Bush were reelected and you were looking for growth, I would look for it in that area, on how he dealt with. And I'd also look for it on how he dealt with the Defense Department. I mean, ultimately, he's got to, it seems to me, delegate less. And that sounds funny because the press ridiculed Carter for 4 years, and we still ridicule Carter for supposedly being, you know, a micromanager. But in wartime, the commander-in-chief is ultimately responsible. And if, for instance, there were too few troops in Iraq, it's up to the president to make sure that the right numbers are there.
One of the things that you were talking about, the president being irrelevant, I want to read you a quote from Ken Auletta's piece in The New Yorker. And this is a quote from Mark McKinnon, who works for the Bush campaign. And so he said that the White House press corps, let's see, it's always been he said that the White House has always been the hottest beat for the best reporters, and now they sit in real-time limbo, lost in the dust of the internet and cable. So his view is that because of technological change, that the White House press corps is no longer relevant in the same way that it once was. What do you think about that kind of observation? And has the role of the White House press changed over time, or has it pretty been is the basic role similar?
What's happened in American journalism is that is the same thing, in a sense, that's happened in American life and American discourse. David Brooks writes a lot about this. People sit around talking to people who agree with them, who, you know, and so liberals go to salon.com and conservatives go to townhall.com. And what happens when you're on those websites is all of your prejudices are reconfirmed. If you're on the liberal sites, Bush is not only stupid, but dishonest. All the stories, same thing, stupid, dishonest, some stupid and dishonest. And if you go to the conservative sites, the liberals actually hate America, want it to fail, want our soldiers to die, are picking on Bush cynically, knowing that he's a great president, because they would rather be France, and they just don't have the wherewithal to move to France. Now, there may be a germ of truth in those two stereotypes. I think not. But the White House press corps has not, we've been slow to adapt to that new world, and thank God. We still write and air for the general audience, for the audience that supposedly is no longer there. We have, you know, what does Adam Nagorny think? You know, there were 20 million swing voters, and now supposedly there's 8. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'd believe that, but we're writing for the 8 million. Mm-hmm. And so a guy like McKinnon, whose job it is to roust the Republican base, to withstand the assault of these unpatriotic scumbuckets, well, he would think we're irrelevant, sure. I don't know, Mark. I like him. He hit the exact in the Kentucky Derby, so he's a smart guy. I didn't hit the exact on the Kentucky Derby. And I know this because he sent me an email beforehand. A lot of people say, I won the Derby. This guy picked Lionheart and Smarty Pants or Smarty Jones or whatever the hell that horse name. He picked it before. So Mark's a smart guy and a musician and a good all-around American. I've got nothing against him. But his role's different than mine. He's looking at politics differently. I'm looking, our job is to make that 8 million be 20 million again and to write stories that appeal to all Americans, that all Americans can read and mm-hmm. find truth in. Mm-hmm. So, I'm not saying he's wrong. I'm saying I'm fighting against that. Uh-huh. That's not what I believe in.
Uh-huh. And I think also, if you look at the first cut of history, it's made by journalists writing about how things have happened, what the responses were, and it's certainly not on those kinds of sites. And it comes from the White House and White House reporting. I mean, if you're going to have I talked to earlier guests about seeing a story about the energy program that the president proposal that he put forward early in his administration, and I read it in College Station, Texas, and the author was Terry Hunt, Associated Press White House correspondent who's not located 100 feet from the Oval Office, right. And that really the White House press corps is the recorder of history in its initial stages, really putting down what the record is of an administration. Talking about the press earlier of people criticizing it reporters were somehow making the president look good at particular time periods or making him look bad, that there seems to often to be a confusion of the press's role is the opposition, that if the opposition, the real political party opposition, is not providing a good counter to the president in terms of programs or that should be introduced or what he has, that somehow it's the press that that should take up the role as the opposition. Have you found that you've been criticized in that way, or that you see press being criticized that way?
Well, yeah, but, you know, sometimes that criticism is warranted. Sometimes we do act like we're the opposition. We're there, we're on the spotlight, we're supposed to ask questions, and sometimes reporters get into the attitude that there's two kinds of questions, fawning questions and hostile questions. And we do this partly because of the criticism level. You know, people are watching us at those press conferences as well as the president. And if those were the two options, and I argue, and you know, and I've said before, I mean, I think there's a third option, to ask a straightforward policy question that's neutral in tone, but tough on substance. I mean, the president flubs it. But if reporters have in their minds, and some of the TV reporters seem to have this, that they can be hostile or fawning, they'll take hostile. Mm-hmm. And that's not necessarily ideological. That's just, we're more iconoclastic. We don't want to be fawning. Mm-hmm. And if that's, it's, you know, and so it's like a race riot in prison. You know, no matter how enlightened you are about race, you better run off with your kind for the first few minutes. And so some of these people act like it's this kind of riot, you know, fawning, hostile, better be hostile. And so that criticism is not, the criticism has some merit. And then you wonder, why can't they come up with better questions? I don't really know the answer. This last press conference, Bush has asked 4 or 5 times, you know, won't you apologize? Well, there was two or three things about that question. Remember, Dick Clark had apologized in the...
Right.
Yeah. Well, one, presidents don't apologize like that. Clark wasn't president. Mm-hmm. That's not his job to do that. His job is to fight the war. It's an ahistoric question. Nobody would really expect, even in these times, a president to do that like that. But the other thing is that... he'd already said that he thought we were doing the right thing. So why would a guy apologize for something he thought was the right thing? And so you'd think after the fourth time he answered it, somebody else would come up with a new question, you know, say, okay, well, and ask another question. Uh-huh. So that criticism, you know, and we didn't get any criticism this time. Boy, we didn't get criticism that we were fawning. We got criticism that we were hostile, so the pendulum had swung.
Yeah.
It'd be better to ask follow-up questions, and I mean of another person's, uh-huh, question. And this has been a problem in that room for 20 years. People come with their question. They don't want to follow somebody else's question.
Uh-huh. He did. David Gregory did follow up.
Yeah.
A bit. But it is unusual.
No, he didn't follow up. No. He pretended to follow up. Uh-huh. He asked his question. He said he was following up. He wasn't following up. Here's a follow-up question. Mr. President, you obviously believe in this mission. You've said so to the first 3 people who asked you about it. You obviously don't think you should apologize, but are you equally convinced that the battle plan in Iraq was right? Are you equally convinced of that? Are you? And I'm talking here about, you went in with 130,000 troops, not 230,000. You went in without a northern front because Turkey shut it off at the last minute. You didn't seal the borders. You didn't have enough generators for Baghdad for the summer, so those people were in 120-degree heat. You disbanded the Iraqi army. How about that? Are you convinced those were the right things? Now, that's a question.
Uh-huh.
It's not a softball question, but it's not a grandstanding.
Uh-huh.
It's not a question. You know, it's a question. And if we've got a fault, it's that we don't pay attention to what's already been said in that press conference, come up with our feet on a new tough question, but that's not hostile, it's neutral in tone, but it puts the guy on the spot.
Mm-hmm. Do you think it goes back to the fact that the press conferences are televised, and that once they're televised, that that editors put more attention to what kinds of questions their reporters asked, and
yes,
so they are
yes,
more interested.
Well, and also, they're on TV. You know, everybody, uh-huh, wants to be on TV. There's a grandstanding aspect to it. Yeah, sure, it's a problem, but you know, we're not going to do away with that technology. We're not going back to the radio.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's like giving women the vote. Was it good or bad? I don't know, but we're going to keep it.
Yeah, you don't want to get beaten to death right here.
No, I'm just saying. There's an inevitability to history.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's take some questions. Towson?
I was wondering what it's like for you to cover a president, both governing and campaigning at the same time, and how how you try to cover both aspects of that?
That's a good question. Bill Clinton's team, when they were in, had this phrase, the perpetual campaign or the permanent campaign, which was unfortunate in a way because it made Clinton sound crass, but all presidents from the moment they get in are at least partially concerned with reelection. And for a number of reasons, not the least of which is that if they don't win reelection, we promptly in the press adjudge them a complete failure. And that's not fair, but we do it. And so all of the policy decisions, even before the campaign year starts, all of the policy decisions are tinged with politics, and not only in our minds. A guy who worked for the Clinton administration once told me that if you came into a meeting and you only knew the merits of the issue and you were unprepared to talk about the politics, people would laugh you out of the meeting. They wouldn't take you seriously. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, if you only knew the politics and didn't know the merits, the president himself would be disdainful of you because he wanted to know both. And they're not always, and they're not mutually exclusive concerns. When President Bush invoked this tariff on steel, it was widely interpreted by us as being an attempt to carry Pennsylvania and Indiana and Alabama and in Ohio in the upcoming election. Now, you can go too far with this. He was going to, you know, if he doesn't carry Indiana and Alabama, you're looking at a 45 straight sweep anyway, but Pennsylvania is a key state. Mm-hmm. And did they ever discuss, and West Virginia, did they ever discuss this? Yes, they had to have. But can they go to the president and just say, just show him the polling numbers? No, because no president would, I don't know, Nixon, but any of the presidents I covered would think that's too cynical. They don't want to be talked to in that way. And so they talk about the merits. Here, these countries are screwing Americans steel industry, and here's how they're doing it with their hidden subsidies. And we're taking this on, Mr. President. We're going to deal with it openly and in a transparent way. So I think the way that you cover it is to be, have your eyes open about the politics, but not get cynical. And you can write stories that have both the politics and the policy, the merits of the policy, in the same story. And I think reporters get in trouble when they are too naive and they don't mention the politics, or when they're too cynical and write in a sort of smart-ass way. What I try to do is just keep them both in mind and not to pretend and not to have as an attitude that there's anything evil about politics. There's nothing necessarily wrong with paying attention to what voters in Pennsylvania want. That's our system of government.
Working off of that, you covered Clinton when he was first running for office. What's the difference in covering somebody before they come into the presidency and then covering them once they're in?
Well, that's a fun exercise. When you cover, do you remember Bob Dole? When he was running in 1996, he would point to these supposed ethical lapses of Bill Clinton, raising money in the Lincoln bedroom and other things. He'd say, "Where's the outrage?" And of course, that was before we even knew about the stuff that would get him impeached. But what Dole was really asking the American people is, do you think this man has the character to be president? It was the wrong question. It was very reminiscent of what McGovern said about Nixon. The answer, of course, is the short answer of is no, but he is the president, and he's done a good job. Or no, but he is president, and I'm only concerned with the job he's doing as president. And so a reelection campaign is fundamentally different. The Democrats are making a great, James Carville said today, Kerry said 2 days ago, "Well, gee, I know more about war. I was in Vietnam. This guy was in the National Guard." Well, that seems to me to be fundamentally the wrong issue to be talking about and utterly beside the point. I want to remind these people, we're in a war now. This guy's the commander-in-chief. It's not that there's lack of issues to talk about. Mm-hmm. And the question is, has he been a good one? And so a reelection campaign is much different. It's a focus on the job a guy's mm-hmm. done in office. Mm-hmm. It's much easier to write about in a way than when you have, mm-hmm. like a guy who's never been in office. What kind of president would John Kerry make? If every reporter, if you put him on sodium pentothal and made him tell you the truth, he'd say, "I've no idea. He's never been president. There is no job that prepares you for it."
Mm-hmm. Do we have a question here?
You guys can ask questions.
Yeah, you can ask.
Jack, Dave, Nick.
Okay, we'll give you a few minutes to come up with one. Towson?
How often does the White House, do you actually get to talk with the White House and get to meet with the White House on different issues, you know, I guess, for the National Journal? I mean, how often do you get to ask the questions, considering, I guess, the secrecy and everything else?
Does he mean officials?
Well, in talking to White House people.
Well, if you're doing the job right, you're talking to somebody every day. And even in this White House, which is information is very tightly controlled, if you place enough calls, you can talk to somebody every day. You don't get to talk to the president every day. If you get to talk to this president once a month, you're doing very good. But, you know, things come up and you need an answer. And I think some of the frustrations of the reporters is sometimes you can't get even the official answer out of them if you're too far ahead of the curve. Well, like all the presidents going back, actually now to Richard Nixon, they have sort of a storyline of a day or a storyline of the week they want to get out. They sometimes get irritated if you want to talk about, you know, wolves when they want to talk about taxes. But you put in the calls and you hope to get called back.
Are there certain kinds of stories that you're more likely to get responses on that you're doing? I mean, they think of National Journal in particular because they are pretty pretty interested in the audiences of each of the news organizations they deal with, and they tend to target that they know when they're talking to somebody who they're going to be writing for. So there's certain kinds of things that they particularly are sensitive to.
They will certainly talk to National Journal about tax and budget and economic issues and things they need to deal with Congress. They know Congress is reading us. They know that members of Congress, we have good, you know, literally hundreds of lines into Congress, and they can communicate with Congress that way or get their story out. I once was trying to reach an official, and I won't say his name, but he's a high-ranking official, and I called, and they said, "What's the subject?" And I wanted to say, and I said, "The subject of my story is how every single thing the Democrats have said about taxes and the budget for the last 40 years has now been proven to be false, and that everything that the Bush administration has said has been proven to be true." There's this pause that the secretary says. I said, "Really? Tell him. Just tell him that." Phone rang later. The guy calls back, and he goes, "Nice try, but I'm still not talking." And he was laughing. So, they don't want to talk, they won't talk.
Okay, I see a hand up there in back. No.
That's someone standing.
Oh, that's someone standing. Okay. Another question?
Here. I bored them to sleep. Look at that. Oh, from our audience here.
Okay. Delia?
Wait. Start over.
Sorry.
Yep.
Both Bill Clinton and George Bush said they loved being president.
Oh, you said just take the microphone.
Take the mic.
Do you want me to repeat the question?
Oh yeah, just
for the third time.
Okay.
Both Bill Clinton and George Bush said they loved being president, and they use that word love. What I'm wondering is how you've seen each of them embrace that job, and did they embrace it in similar ways or in different ways? Why is it they use that word? Why is it that they've embraced their job in the way, say, Theodore Roosevelt did? He talked about loving being president also.
Well, you know, they came to the job very different ways. Bill Clinton wanted to be president, actively wanted to be president, and sought to be president since he was 16 years old, and probably earlier than that, when he went with Boys Nation to the White House and he met John F. Kennedy, who had that effect on a lot of young people. It must have been this great thing for this kid, no dad from Arkansas, good student, well-liked in class, but kind of a nerdy guy, didn't play football, didn't serve in the military, didn't do anything Kennedy did as a young man, and wasn't from a great family like that. And yet they met, and he thought, "I want to be president, I want this job." And, you know, you think about the old phrase, only in America, any boy can be robbed to be president. Something that I noticed when I went to Jimmy Carter's hometown, to their, the farm where Carter grew up is there. And the idea that a person could come off that farm and be president, this is a farm out of the 19th century. And it's miraculous. George Bush comes totally opposite. A family, third generation blue bloods all the way back. His father, grandfather Prescott, household name in this country before World War II, a senator, or afterward, a great mm-hmm. senator, very well known. His father, president. And even at the time his father is president, Bush has no outward political ambitions. If he wants to be president, he's never even talked about it. And yet, people come to him. It runs for governor. He obviously has an interest in politics because you remember this National Guard thing that he's taken so much heat mm-hmm. for. What was he doing? He was working on a campaign. And so he has this interest in politics, and it's always latent, even if it's hidden sometimes from himself, and then he runs for president. And they both get the job. And you think about that job, and you think about how unlikely it would be that a normal person could be happy in it. The stress is uncanny. No offense to my host here, but their hair turns white within days of taking the job. They have to have armed guards, you know, to go to the company to go to the bathroom so they won't be, you know, assassinated. There's no privacy whatsoever. People ask them the most impertinent questions all day long, the rest of their lives. And yet, these two guys are happy and love the job. It reminds me, John F. Kennedy, at some level, it's unknowable how they could. John F. Kennedy once said that pursuing the presidency is not a normal ambition. And so even though we think of this right to attain the presidency from a person from humble backgrounds like Clinton and Carter, wanting to have the job means that you're different from everyone else in some marked way, mm-hmm. and even more than a movie star. And you have this complete loss of privacy. You're written about and dissected, and there's demonstrations against you and hung in effigy. And you have to have a hell of a thick skin and a real sense of calling to even want it. And so the people who pursue it, they're different, you know, to paraphrase F. Scott Fitzgerald. Presidents are different from you and I. But these two have taken a particular joy in it. And in the little things, Bill Clinton, who never played baseball, I don't even think he played Little League baseball. He got to throw out the first ball at Oriole Park, and he prepared for it. In 1993, he got a mitt out. I didn't even know he had a mitt. Somebody got him a mitt, and he'd warm up out in secret. He noticed George Bush Sr., who bounced the ball at home plate, said, I'm not right. going to bounce the ball. Yeah. And he didn't. He didn't throw it very good, but he didn't bounce it.
I think in your story, it was the strike, was it not?
Yeah, I gave him it. I gave him a little, about 6 inches high and outside, yeah. didn't I? I wrote about that, and Bush said this. Bush says similar things. He takes delight in these things. He told me the other day we were at the dinner, something about planning, and he kind of looked at me, sort of laughed. He said, well, you know, I have people take care of that sort of thing for me, you know. And he said it in a self-deprecating way, but you could also say he was pleased. He had people taking care of the stuff that I had to worry about. Yeah. And so I guess in their case, it frees them to think great thoughts and pursue little joys all at the same time. And it's in a way unimaginable, but I'm glad they like the job. I have a theory I'll have to get Martha and her political scientists working on, that people who like the job make better presidents, but it's just that, a hunch. Uh-huh.
And also it's the idea, too, of making a difference, that here you are in a position where you really can make a difference in the choices you make, and that you think that you can leave the country or the world better for what it is that you're doing. And that must be.
I agree with that.
Yeah.
You know, we can get cynical about politicians. They say and do so much to make us cynical, but most of them go into office. They don't go into office thinking, I'm going to be a self-aggrandizing jerk. They mm-hmm. go into office thinking, I'm going to give something back to my community. I'm mm-hmm. going to do something for the state or. Mm-hmm. Anniversary. And we go and we look at the sites. And sometimes in previous administrations, I think they asked the TV people, you know, what would make a good shot, mm-hmm. a picture. This White House is careful not to do that, mm-hmm. either because they don't care what we think or I don't know. But
they have their own people.
They have their own people.
With a network background. They have yeah. Scott Sforza. They
That's
just
right.
take Scott Sforza along.
That's right. They do that. So they didn't ask us any questions, but they let us tag along. And when they want to talk about something privately, they huddle and they put us on a separate bus. It's very much being a second-class citizen. But I didn't go to hang around with them. I went to go to Normandy. And I got to walk on the battlefields alone and the beaches of Normandy. It was very moving, actually. Uh-huh. That was a trip I took myself. You see, it comes in, who are you going to sign? And I waited uh-huh. until it was too late to assign anyone else and just took the trip. The only perk.
I think people just don't have an idea of how expensive it really is to travel with the president. Can you give us some ideas in a couple of trips that the president has taken, like his trip to Asia? Do you remember how much those
fee for the charter itself, and that includes meals and some of the filing center costs, but not all, was about $22,000, 8-day trip.
Uh-huh. That so was you, one to
yeah,
Asia.
To Asia, and he went yeah. to all these countries, Singapore and Australia, mm-hmm. of course, the summit at Tokyo, mm-hmm. the event itself, he stopped in Bali. The event mm-hmm. itself was in Thailand, so we did all these countries in 7 days. Yeah. It'd be expensive if you wanted to fly anyway, but still, you can see, extrapolate on one right. week of travel,
yeah.
how expensive it is for these papers like the LA Times and the New York Times and the Washington Post that make every trip.
Mm-hmm.
It's several hundred thousand dollars a year.
How many news organizations do make all the trips?
Well, those three newspapers, and they're the only ones now, those
uh-huh.
three papers that make every trip. The Wall Street Journal and the USA Today make most of the trips.
Uh-huh.
The Wires, Reuters and AP and Bloomberg make all the trips,
mm-hmm.
usually with two people.
Uh-huh.
And then the networks, of course. The networks make...
It's a lot of freelance pieces in addition to his White House work. So we have a variety of things to ask him about and the experiences that he brings to his work. Carl, can you tell us something, since you've got fresh in your mind the Correspondents Association? What is it that the White House Correspondents Association does?
Well, its original purpose, I won't say its original purpose, but its primary purpose is to interact with the White House and ensure we get access to the president. And you know from your time over there, the inclination of every president is to keep us at bay. And the last three or four administrations has had a plan to take our White House press room away from us right there in the uh-huh. the main, and move us across to the old executive office buildings, now the old Eisenhower building. This plan's so old, the buildings changed names, but they uh-huh. still haven't gotten us over there yet. And so the president of the White House Correspondents Association is supposed to deal with the White House and all these issues, where we can go in the building, access to the president on trips, when we take trips, the charters. It's the truth of it is it's a much more involved job. Nobody who knew what you have to do would actually take the job. But by the time you find out, you're in your term, it's a 1-year term, and then you leave. But that's its primary job. We also have a scholarship program, and we're very proud of, and we do that.
You've done a lot of work in building up that scholarship program.
Well, when I first came in, we were getting some bad publicity. There's always these snotty stories written. The Washington Post had a couple of them the last 2 days about our dinner, which uh-huh. is our sort of third great function to do this dinner. And I thought, we're doing all this stuff, and this scholarship program we have, it's okay, but we don't put enough time and energy into it. And so I revamped it a little bit, and my idea was to make it more for students, based a little more on need, and have it be oriented towards kids who want to someday cover the White House, maybe.
Uh-huh.
That's my idea. And so, yeah, I put some time into that.
Uh-huh.
And then there's the dinner itself, which is one night a year, and we get together. And the president really wasn't conversant with it. And I know when he came to office, it's something he wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this war has forced him to reorder his priorities, and baseball is no longer where it was with him, which was an interesting
uh-huh.
thing I noticed. I was uh-huh. disappointed in a way, because I like baseball in Washington.
Yeah.
But he's not engaged in that anymore. But he also talked about, some of his conversations 2 years ago at the dinner. He talked about Yasser Arafat and how disappointed he was that Arafat didn't seem to be able to go from
mm-hmm.
revolutionary to mm-hmm. statesman, to make that leap for peace.
Uh-huh.
He talked about that in front of us
uh-huh.
Without hesitation.
Uh-huh.
So it runs the whole gamut.
Uh-huh. Oh, that is interesting. In the work kind of work that you all do in dealing with access issues, how much time does that kind of thing take up? How often are there issues? Are there just a constant stream of issues that need to be dealt with?
There are issues daily. They range from what charter should we get, and the press play. When we follow the president around, we pay our expenses, as you know. We pay the plane, we pay the hotel, the phones, everything. It's very expensive to travel with the president. And these news organizations that do spend many more times as amount as they would on the salary of an extra reporter. So it's a commitment. Mm-hmm. And then we have to pick the plane, and the networks and I vote, and it's kind of involved. Every day you do something like that.
Uh-huh.
And then there are site surveys where a president goes on foreign trips. They send out, the White House sends a team of advanced people. We're allowed to tag along so we can write a report for our people on what to see in the country. The Correspondents Association president has to find someone to take those trips. And mm-hmm. there's just, it's kind of boring, but it's time consuming.
Uh-huh. Well, you took a recent trip. In preparation for the president's trip to Normandy.
Right.
What kinds of things do you do on a trip like that?
Well, that is off the record, but I'll tell you what I can tell you.
Yeah.
I mean, it's no secret the president's going to Normandy. That's the 60th anniversary. Now it's a big thing because Hollywood people come, but before it was not that. It's a time, and if you're a White House correspondent, for every Hollywood person that goes, there's 50 or 100 or 200 source types, you know, Washington mm-hmm. professionals, everybody from Karl Rove down to a press secretary in a congressman's office that some local reporter is taking. And you go to the dinner and you dress up in a tuxedo, and that one night a year you're not doing battle. You're trying to get to meet the person on the other side.
Uh-huh.
And form, you know, make a source and have a good time.
Uh-huh.
Salute the president.
Somebody was asking me the other night, when you talk to the president, what is the protocol? And what kinds of things do you talk about and not talk about? I know it's off the record, so.
You know, it's not really off the record.
Uh-huh.
It's I hesitate to even say this on, but you got a nice looking class there. I'll go ahead and it's ambiguous.
It's also video streaming.
That's fine, but the truth of it is, for many years, there's an ambivalence to it,
uh-huh.
of whether it's off the record or not. That for that one, you couldn't have that be any kind of permanent situation, but for that one night. It serves its purposes because there's certain. If the president really wants to keep something a secret, he knows not to tell three reporters on a stand in front of 2,000 other reporters.
Right.
So he's not up there spilling secrets. But on the other hand, if he, if he belches into his napkin, you know, or says some aside to his wife about how crummy the entree was, we don't use that. I don't think we're supposed to.
Uh-huh.
But like I say, presidents don't spill state secrets by accident. So there's not. There's not that kind of thing. The idea is that you're up there with him. He doesn't have to come to the dinner. He doesn't have to sit with him. So you're not going to use something that would gratuitously embarrass him. That at least is my understanding.
Uh-huh. And the kinds of things that you talk about, like you talk about sports and...
Well, President Bush, in the 2 years I've had dinner with
Carl
him...
Carl is a really good baseball
player. I like baseball, and so does Bush.
Yeah.
We talk about baseball, but really he's less interested in that than he was. We talked two nights ago about bringing baseball to Washington,
mm-hmm.
and
welcome to our sessions on White House communications from the perspective of officials and reporters. Tonight we have as our guest Carl Cannon, who is fresh from the White House Correspondents Association dinner, where Carl is president. He's just finished up a year as president of the White House Correspondents Association, and he was the one who had to organize the dinner. And if you think about the hassle that's involved in organizing a dinner for about 10 or 15 people, you can imagine what it must be like to organize a dinner for 2,700. And 2,700 people, who some of whom have fairly large egos, and a sense of where they'd like to sit and with whom they would like to sit. So Carl is, in addition to his role as president of the Correspondents Association, which we will we'll talk about how far back that goes. Carl is a White House correspondent for National Journal. You know, as you know, there are two White House correspondents. We had Alexis Simmendinger came in, and we had a session with Alexis in the classroom. And Carl, before he was at National Journal, worked for the Baltimore Sun. And before the Baltimore Sun, he worked for several newspapers, including the San Jose Mercury News. So you have both a California experience and a Maryland experience. Carla is known for his very good writing and for the scope of his stories, that he always corrals a lot of information and a lot of people in a large variety of stories. He writes not just about the White House, but there are a lot of other issues that he's interested in, that he's written about, such as death penalty and issues that have nothing to do with politics. For example, Carl has written about wolves, and so he does.